Hello, I'm Dr. Stephen Scavelli, and this is End Time Revival Ministries. My very special guest is one of God's generals, Pastor Eddie Shannon. Pastor Shannon is a pastor, a teacher, and a lecturer at Under the Blood Church in Ybor City. Pastor Shannon, thank you so much for being on the show.
Thank you for having me here.
Pastor, I'm going to start right away with this question. Do you believe we are living in the end times?
Yes, I believe we're living in the end times because of the signs of the times. And also when we look at the church in general as a whole, amen, we can see the things that are going on.
Now, the Lord makes this statement in Matthew 24:36. But of that day and hour knoweth no man, no, not the angels of heaven, but my Father only. But as the days of Noah were, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. Can you elaborate on that, sir?
Amen. What God is saying in this text, amen, that no one knows the day nor the hour when Jesus is to return.
Yeah.
And as in the days of Noah, amen, it goes on in the scripture and it tells us that they was eating, they were drinking, they was marrying, giving in marriage.
Yeah.
And ain't nothing wrong with eating and drinking and marriage. God constituted marriage. But at the same time, we have to put our focus on God. See, what happened was they had got their focus off of God, off of who created them, off of who gave them life, amen, who God wanted them to him to be their center of attention. And because of that, amen, because their focus was off God, it caused God to wrath, amen, because God is, the Bible lets us know that God is a jealous God. And so because their focus wasn't on God, it caused, amen, the flood to come. And when the flood came, amen, only Noah and his family was saved from the flood, and everyone else on earth died. And this end time, you know, we have to have our focus on God. The church has gotten so complacent. They have gotten to the state to where they come into church, they are pew warmers, they don't want to do anything for God. God wants us for his service. That's why God calls us. He calls us to serve not only him, but our brothers and our sisters in the community, our brothers and our sisters as our neighbors. God calls us to serve, not to just come and sit down. And so the reason God is getting ready, I think God is getting ready to do something drastic now in this day and time because of all the things that are going on and the signs of the times, because the people was warned by Noah as he preached for over 100 years to let them know, look, this is coming, this is coming. They had never seen rain before. They didn't know what rain was, but he warned them just as ministers and teachers and pastors and bishops and apostles of God are warning the people now that Jesus is coming soon. And when Jesus comes, amen, if you're not ready, if you're not prepared, if you're not right with God, you will be left behind. And when judgment day comes, hell will be your home.
It sounds like Matthew 24, Jesus talks about wars. And he speaks about rumors of wars, and he speaks about nation rising against nation and kingdom against kingdom. And he also says something very interesting, that he says that the love of many shall wax cold. Pastor, I think we're seeing this at an alarming, rapid pace. Now in Matthew 25, the Lord speaks about the 10 virgins.
Right.
Now, can you elaborate on that, please?
Yes. Before I do 25, though, I want to elaborate on what you just spoke on about the wars and rumors of wars, because we have war going on right here in America.
Sure.
You know, it's not a, people says that racial crime and, you know, black on black crime, black on white, all these racial tensions and everything that's going on in this country, but it's still war.
Yeah.
It's not only just physical war, but it's spiritual war.
Sure.
We have spiritual wars going on inside the church.
Yeah.
And the thing of it is, until we come together as a people of God and pray and seek his face and turn from our wicked ways, that's the only way change is going to come. But until we do that, amen, change is not going to happen when you got this crew over here and this crew over here in the same church fighting against each other.
Sure. The Apostle Paul said that, we don't wrestle against flesh and blood.
Right, right.
We're wrestling against principalities and powers and rulers and spiritual hosts of wickedness. And sometimes I believe the devil, he just lets us go. And he's laughing at us.
Yes, yes.
Because, we're not working. It's not about being black or white or orange or pink. The apostle said there's no Jew, no Gentile, no Greek for those in Christ Jesus.
Right.
It's time that the church get their act together and understand that the Lord gave a list and he's coming very, very soon.
Right. And the thing of it is when God comes in Matthew 25, where it talks about the 10 virgins, with the 10 virgins, five was wise, five was foolish.
Yeah.
You had the five wise, they took oil in their lamps, and then you had the five foolish that took no oil.
Yeah.
And the thing of it is the five foolish in their mindset, if you think about what they was thinking and what they was doing, their mindset was, I got time.
Mm.
I got time. Why? I don't need to get no oil, And they didn't know, it talks in the text of how they went to sleep.
Yeah.
And they slept their time away when they should have been going to get oil, when they should have been preparing. See, it's all about preparation.
Yeah.
God wants us to prepare now for what's to come. And if we don't prepare for what's to come, even in this text, you can look at it as salvation, because the five foolish, they missed out on their salvation. They didn't even receive deliverance from God because of what they did, of their actions. And we, as a people of God, we have to make conscious choices because our choices, amen, brings an action and a reaction.
Yeah.
And if our actions aren't right because of our conscious choice, it's going to bring a bad reaction.
Sure.
And so what people have to realize is those five foolish virgins, they missed out on the blessing of God of going back with him because they didn't have no oil to put in their lamps. And, the Bible lets us know that even when the bridegroom came, the cry went out, the bridegroom is coming.
Yeah.
In Jewish history, amen, the bridegroom, it will be a cry made, and they'll let you know when the bridegroom is coming. And that's when all the virgins would get together and light their lamps so he could see how to go, his direction, his path. And so when the bridegroom was coming, amen, the five foolish, first thing they say is, give us some of your oil.
Yeah.
But it ain't. I don't have enough for me and you.
Mm.
I don't have enough to give you some of my oil because I have just enough to light the way. And when you prepare, you just enough is good enough.
Yeah.
You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
When you prepare, when you are prepared, when you know that, look, I don't need to overdo it.
Yeah.
But I just need just enough.
Sure.
And they had just enough oil for their lamps, and the five foolish had no oil. So what the five foolish do? They beg, they go around begging, and what it is they, I heard Pastor Neil say this, they stayed gone too long because they went to get the oil, but it was too late when they got back.
Yeah.
And they went too far away because your distance and what you do, it causes you to miss out on God sometimes.
Mm-hmm.
So we have to realize that God calls us to do great things. He wants us to do great things. And when God gives us the okay to do it, we have to do it.
Mm-hmm.
We can't sit down on God. We can't say, just like back in Noah's day, they was all drinking, they having fun, they doing what they was doing. And when it started to rain, now they scrambling to do everything.
Yeah.
But when it comes down to God, we must realize that we don't have to scramble to do stuff if we just do it.
Mm-hmm.
The Bible said, "Blessed are they that not just hear the word, but they that hear the word and do the word."
Sure.
So the difference is you have to be a doer as well as a hearer in order to get a good result from God. And so that's what the 10 virgins, the five foolish virgins missed out on, because they knew they was walking with the saints. They were going along with the other virgins. They were doing what the other virgins was doing.
Sure.
But when the time came, like we say, when the rubber met the road, they couldn't do it. And it's like that today, even with church members today, church members in the church, they walk with the saints, they talk with the saints, they know how to stand up and clap their hands, they know how to sing the song, they know how to close their eyes and wave their hands, wave your hands in the air like you just don't care. They know how to do all that stuff. But when the rubber meets the road, we talking about a falling away, when the pressure comes and when the test comes, you know, don't get me wrong, we all fall down, but we get back up.
Sure.
But when the pressure and the test really comes, do you stay down?
Yeah.
That makes the difference. That's the difference between a saint and a sinner.
It's amazing. There's like a comparison here when it seems like that Noah prepared.
Right.
And he was wise.
Right.
And the people, and he preached for 100 years, and they mocked him.
Right.
And he was a preacher of righteousness.
Righteousness.
So I see a wise man following the Spirit of God.
Right.
And the people, they actually, they perished. But God didn't want them to perish. God wanted them to come to him.
Right.
And to be filled with oil. Does that sound correct?
That's right. And the thing about, and what I love about, when you look at the picture of Noah, you know, it's the same today with Jesus Christ.
Huh.
You know, Jesus Christ is the vehicle to take us to heaven.
Sure.
And Noah's ark was the vehicle that saved the people of God. And so what we realize is that in order to get with God, you had to get in the ark.
Sure.
Those that got in the ark got saved, but those that didn't get in the ark, they perished. And it's the same comparison when you look at Revelation, when you look at the Bible in its context, is if you're in the ark of safety in Christ Jesus, you shall be saved.
Yes.
You know, John 3:16, I mean, we realize all we have to do is just accept God.
Mm.
And he will save us. He will equip us. In preparation, you cannot fall out during the test. So many people fall out during the test because when God is preparing you, when God is grooming you, when God is maturing you and making you, that's when you must realize that, look, I got to stay in this test. No matter how many times I fall down, no matter how much hard tests and trials I go through, I still have to stay in the test. And people must understand that in order to stay in the test, you're going to have to be on your knees. You're going to have your face on the floor before God. It's going to take some tries, some tests, and some pain.
Yeah.
But you still have to stay in the fight.
Sure.
You can't give up.
Sure.
End time revival, you know, we talking about end time revival. We talking about people, you know, God wants to call the church back to him.
Yeah.
But we cannot, I think it's in Isaiah, I'm not sure, but I think in the book of Isaiah, it talks about we can't just go to God and give him lip service.
Sure.
God wants our service. He wants us to be real with him.
Yes.
If you are not strong enough to do for God, ask God to strengthen you.
Yes.
Ask God to empower you. God can do it.
Yes.
But you have to trust God.
Sure.
You have to believe God at his word.
Now, do you believe that, now it says in 1 Thessalonians, now we beseech you, brethren, by the coming of the Lord, that some will fall away.
Right.
There'll be scoffers, there'll be people walking after their own lust and say, where is he?
Mm-hmm.
Where is the God that you have spoken about
right.
all these years? And we've heard this. And this is more or less maybe what the five virgins did.
Right.
You know, they just didn't believe or they fell away and they fell into judgment, no?
Yes. And the thing about it, Dr. Scavelli, is, you know, we have to recognize that what God is doing in our lives and God is transforming us. And when things are going wrong, I want to stress that we have to stay in the fight.
Yeah.
We can't give up and turn around and go back, because what God has placed inside of us is something that's wonderful, is marvelous.
Yes.
You know, the Bible said we are wonderfully and marvelously made.
Sure.
And so God has put something inside of us, and we have to have the courage and the strength we have to be to the point to where challenges won't make us turn back.
Yeah.
Because, see, when you challenge people, a lot of people want to turn back.
Sure.
It's just like in Jesus' day. I taught this in Bible study Wednesday night.
Yeah.
In Jesus' day, when Jesus told his disciples, he said, unless you drink of my cup, drink of my blood, eat of my flesh, you cannot be my disciple.
Sure.
And the Bible said many of his disciples turned back.
Yeah.
Now, they turned back because they weren't hearing what they wanted to hear. But their excuse was, we can't eat of your flesh and we can't drink of your blood. And Jesus was speaking spiritual. And so if they had heard the instructions of God, that's what's so important to us. If we hear God's instruction, God has given us instructions in the book. And if we hear his instructions, yeah, and do what he tells us to do. And when I say do what he tells us to do, I mean line upon line and precept upon precept. We have to follow God's instructions. If we follow God's instructions to the letter, we cannot fail.
Yes, this is true.
We cannot fail. And what people don't understand is following God's instruction, it lets us know that we're going to have tribulations, we're going to have trials, we're going to have persecution.
Yes.
I mean, it lets us know these things. So following God's instructions is what is going to get us to that next level. It's what's going to get us into heaven. It's what's going to get us, amen, to be on earth what God wants us to be. God don't want everybody to be rich on earth. You know, I love prosperity preaching, but God don't want everybody to be rich on earth. God wants some poor people too.
Sure.
God wants some people middle class.
Sure.
God wants some people upper class.
Yeah.
But knowing all of this, we should have in our hearts that no matter what, I'm going to do what God wants me to do.
Yeah.
Because whether I'm rich or whether I'm poor, God is the one that made me. God is the one that is equipped in me. God is the one that's building me up to be everything I can be for him.
Sure.
You know, when you use your resources and what you have to serve God, that's what matters.
Yeah.
You know, it's just like this show. I love the concept of what you and your wife are doing on this show. You using your resources to serve God. And that's what it's all about. We are to use our resources, our gifts, our talents to serve God. Just like the 10 virgins, they had talent. They could have, they had the lamps. You know, all that God wanted was some light.
Yeah.
But they was too lazy to go get the oil, you know. And the Bible lets us know in all through the New Testament, when Jesus talks a lot of time, he called people like the guy who had the guy that he gave the 10 talents to. He called him a wicked and lazy servant because he just didn't want to do it.
When you really read this right here, it seems like, I might be wrong, but the five foolish virgins, they kind of like judgment was pronounced upon them, and I don't think they made it. You know?
No, I don't either, because the door was shut.
Sure.
And see that when you're looking at that through spiritual eyes, it's letting you know that it's the same thing and happening. It's going to happen in heaven. You know, you get there, and that's why it's so important. It tells us in the 13th verse, on the 25th chapter, 13th verse, it says, "Watch therefore, for ye know neither the day nor the hour wherein the Son of Man cometh." And it lets you know that, you know, we have to be on the lookout because Jesus is coming every day.
Yes.
And that's what people don't understand. Everybody's so focused on the big ending when he show up in the eastern sky.
Sure.
But he's coming every day, and every day he's taking a number. And so what we have to do is be prepared that when our number is called, that we go back with him.
Sure.
And that's what's so important. You know, you need to do all you can. I need to do all I can for service to God.
Yes.
And when we do what we can and when we give our talents and giftings and resources and everything that God has called us to give to him, you know, that's what God looks for.
Yeah.
That's how we honor God.
Sure.
That's how we worship God. That's how we praise. All these things brings, you know, all these things add up to worship and praise and giving glory to God, you know. I'll give you an example. I went to church today, and I went to buy some communion pans.
Sure.
And I get to the church, and I look down, and somebody else had already bought them. But that was somebody else. Deacon Greg, Deacon Washington had already went and bought the pans, and I bought some. But the thing about it is we both had our mindset on serving God. That was going to be a way of we going to serve God. And, you know, our communication was off, but we both did it.
Yeah.
That's what God wants. God wants someone to step in and say, look, I know this area is lacking right here in service. Yeah. I want to be the one to do that.
Yeah.
I want to be the one to do the ushering. I want to be the one to do the preaching. I might not be able to preach, but I want to be able to be the one that's singing. I want to be the one that's sweeping the floor.
Sure.
I mean, every gift and every talent comes in and it glorifies God.
Sure.
And that's what God wants.
Yeah.
God, and that's when in the days of Noah, instead of them doing all this partying and drinking and all this stuff they were doing, if they had just been trying to put their service into God, And God don't mind you drinking and eating and giving in marriage, and he don't mind that, but he wants his focus, your focus, to be on him.
Yes.
And that's where we are missing in that. The enemy has come with social media, Facebook, all these tools to get our focus off God.
Yeah.
And, you know, because sometimes I have to break myself out of Facebook sometimes.
Sure.
You know, we be on Facebook looking and, you know, and he gets our focus off God on that kind of stuff. And then we weaken spirit because we are not worshiping and praising God and giving God our time and giving God, you know, our worship and praise.
Sure.
And we miss out on our blessings because of it.
Well, we're supposed to be in season and out of
season.
Prayed up, praying in the spirit.
Right.
And with the virgins here, do you see this for the modern day church?
Yes. Yes, it you know, we talking about a great falling away.
Yes.
You know, when you're talking about a falling away, I've seen it firsthand.
Yes.
And that's the thing about it. Yeah. You've seen it firsthand probably, where you have a person comes into the church and they're gung-ho when they first start.
Yes.
But then all of a sudden you just see them fall away.
Sure.
And then when you go talk to them, you know, they swearing, they doing all this stuff, and you're like, hey, you know, what happened to you? You know, you it's like a Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde situation, you know. You're like, what happened to you?
Sure.
You know, and you try to draw them back, you try to talk to them, you show them love, but ultimately they stay right where they are.
Sure.
In the same condition.
Yeah.
And that's falling away. I mean, it really breaks your heart when you see that.
Yes, sir.
Because you really, you know, it's God's will that all men be saved.
Yes, sir.
And so you want to see all men saved. You want all men to know that they have, you know, we have deliverance in Christ Jesus.
Yes.
You know, Jesus has delivered us and set us free and made us,
yes,
you know, and he's working on us. He's making us whole.
Yes.
And it breaks your heart when you see
that.
But even though we have to know in our heart of hearts that a lot of time when that happened, the person's heart wasn't in it.
Sure.
They weren't serving God with their whole heart. And that's what God wants. That's what God wants. He wants us to serve him with our whole heart. He don't want 99 and a half.
Sure.
He wants your whole heart of service to him. And, you know, as I said, that breaks your heart. That makes you and it gets your mind wondering sometimes, you know, whoa, what caused them to be in that state?
Sure.
You know, but we as a people of God have to, our job is to preach the word, teach the word, and go on. You know, we are to show love and compassion.
Yes.
But at the same time, we must realize that we have to preach and teach God's word and go on at a pace.
Yes.
You know, we can't allow them to bring us down or confuse our mind and make us miss out on what God has for us.
Yes. Well, can you imagine how frustrating the Lord must be?
Right.
Because God, you know, is looking down from heaven, he's not trying to hurt you or destroy you. He actually loves you, and he wants you to come to him so you can be forgiven and washed and cleansed of all sin.
Right.
Look, it's not about being perfect. I'll be the last one to tell you that, okay? I've said this many times on the show. You know, we're living in a time of grace, and I'm not saying that so we can go out and sin and all this and that. But if we fall, we have the Lord we can go to, and we can confess our sin, and we can be made whole and washed. And I believe, like I said before on many other shows, I believe people think they're too great a sinner, and they say, how can God love me?
Well, the key to that is God loved the worst of sinners.
Yes.
I mean, it's no level of sin in God's eyesight. Sin is sin.
Yes.
And what I want the people to know is that it doesn't matter how much you've sinned or how gross your sin is, God still loves you, and God is able to cleanse you and wash you and make you white as snow. And he loves you so much that he does not want to see you in that fallen state. He don't want to see you in that condition. And because he loves you so much, he will change you from the inside out. You will not have to continue on that road that you're on, but you must trust him. Once you put your trust and your belief in him, he can start to change you, and you must have a made up mind that it's all about God and not about me.
Yes. And if you're out there right now, I want you to know that Jesus loves you.
Yes.
You may have heard it before from other ministers, but no, really, it's not a cliche. It's not something that we say. We say this because we really want you to be born again. Jesus said,
"That's right.
You cannot inherit the kingdom of God. You must be born again. But Jesus was talking spiritual.
Right.
Right, Pastor?
Right.
Pastor, I want you to go to the people, and I want you to give a salvation message, if you don't mind.
Sir. Yes. You know, as we said earlier, it's not too late. You haven't stayed gone too long. As long as there's breath in your body, you have a chance to receive salvation and receive the deliverance of the Lord. God said, whosoever will, let him come. God let us know, he said, John 3:16, God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him shall have everlasting life. And all it takes is your mind being made up that I'm going to believe you, God, and I'm going to trust you. That word believe means to trust. It means to adhere, means to cling to Christ. And that's, Lord, that's what I'm going to do. I have made up my mind, and I'm going to cling to you, God, and I'm going to trust you. And I'm going to believe in you that you would build me and make me into the person I want to be. I've seen God do it with drunks. I've seen God do it with drug addicts. I've seen God do it with whoremongers. I've seen God do it with prostitutes. He can do it for you. You have not gone too far that God's hand can't reach out and save you.
Go ahead and just say a quick prayer real quick.
Father, in the name of Jesus, God, we just thank you for each and everything that has been accomplished here, that has been said here today, God. And we pray right now in the name of Jesus, God, for that brother, that sister, God, that is going through, God, that's suffering, God, right now in the name of Jesus, God. We just pray, God, that you put your hands on their lives, God. God, you said no man can come to you unless they are drawn of you. God, we know that you are drawing your people together for a great revival, God. And we pray right now that revival hit this land like never before, God, and that you move on your people in Jesus' name, we pray. Amen.
Amen. If you said that prayer, please contact me at drscavelli@icloud.com. Now, Jesus is coming very soon. I don't know how much time we have, Pastor, but the signs are there. The nation is in distress financially and spiritually. The Lord is coming. The Lord is coming very soon.
Yes.
Pastor, I want to thank you for being on the show.
Thank you for having me.
Yes, sir. I love your preaching. He's a talented preacher. He preaches at Under the Blood Church in Ybor City. Go there. Be filled. And accept Jesus as Lord. He's coming very, very soon. I'm Dr. Stephen Scavelli, and this is End Time Revival Ministries. May the Lord richly bless you. See you next time.